Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to our first Food for Thought for 2017. My name is Brianne Roth. I'm the Public Programs Coordinator here at the Nantucket Historical Association, and I want to welcome you all for joining us today. Before we get things started, if everyone could please check your cell phones and make sure they're on silent, so we don't disrupt today's lecture. Before we get things started today, I'd like to take a moment to say that all of our programs here at the NHA are made possible with support from our members. Your NHA membership helps us accomplish all the things that we do every single day. And for our members, we thank you. And if you have not joined yet, please visit one of the friendly folks at the front desk after the program or go to nha.org to join today. Every little bit helps, and thank you. Today's Food for Thought is brought to you by the MS Worthington Foundation, and media sponsorship is generously provided by Novation Media. Today's lecture features Melissa Murphey, Director of Culture and Tourism for the Town of Nantucket, previously known as Visitor Services. Melissa's expertise lies in blending creativity, planning, and innovation to meet strategic and financial goals for organizations for maximum community impact. Currently, she is using these skills to support initiatives around the important economic engines of cultural heritage, event management, and tourism on Nantucket. Until February of 2016, Melissa was the executive director of the Nantucket Dreamland Foundation, a nonprofit film and performing arts center in the heart of downtown. Beginning in 2009 as development director, Melissa was part of the team responsible for the successful completion of the capital and building campaigns to restore the beloved theater to the community. Melissa lives on Nantucket year-round with her husband, two children, and their two Jack Russell Terriers. Please join me in giving a warm welcome to Melissa Murphey.
Thank you, Brian.
Thank you. This is my moment to feel like Britney Spears with my headpiece on, so thank you. And thank you to everyone for taking the time out of their day today to join me and the NHA. Thanks to the NHA for this invitation. I'd like to give a really special thank you to Bill Trampash, who can't be here today, but he's been a mentor to me in a lot of ways for a very long time, but he reached out to me, and I'll tell you more about this, but he gave me the invitation to attend the Hong Korea Symposium in South Korea, which sort of kicked off the creation of this presentation that I'm going to share with you today. So I'm going to walk you through a small introduction of our department and what we do and how we do what we do, a little bit about my trip to Busan in South Korea and the presentation on Nantucket's transitions from a whaling economy to a tourist economy. And then if time permits, and you know, if I'm really nervous and I speak really fast, we'll have a lot of time, or if I'm really deliberately slow, we may have no time, to talk a little bit about tourism and tourism funding today, and how our office works with a Chamber of Commerce in a really collaborative and important way to make sure that that economic engine is viable and sustainable. So, this is our mission. Town of Nantucket's Department of Culture and Tourism's mission is to promote tourism and positive on-island experiences for residents and visitors, foster the growth of the island's cultural community, and support all events and filming in public places. And I have to give you the caveat that just because we support them doesn't mean we approve everyone. So, but we do want to make sure that every event and film production that takes place on the island is done so in a safe way for the greatest benefit of people in the community. So we also have a 7-member committee, the Visitor Services Advisory Committee, and I'm not sure I see any of them able to be here today, but they are a great group. We meet once a month, and those meetings are public meetings. If you can't attend, somebody did not get the memo. Just kidding. I'm just kidding, Mary Beth. Just kidding. I'm totally just kidding. That would have been me too. Let me give you a little introduction about our team. This is me. I hate photographs. Ironically, I used to be a photographer. This is David Sharp, our director of visitor services coordinator, and this is Carlisle Jensen, our special event and film permit coordinator. David and Carlisle, will you just stand up and say hi so people know who you are? Yay, team! And you heard a really nice introduction about me at the start of the program. Just to make it a little bit more familiar for you, my mother and I moved to Nantucket in 1982, and I was the ripe old age of seven. I'm sorry, I was 83. I was seven turning eight. And my mom had just recently divorced my father, and she wanted to move as far away from him as she possibly could. God rest both of their souls. And she couldn't leave the state of Massachusetts because of the way the divorce agreement was written. So her best friend, who was living on Nantucket and a nurse at the hospital, said, "Oh God, just come move out to Nantucket. This will be really easy. We'll get Melissa right into school. I'm sure I can get you a job. And trust me when I tell you, he will never come here. It's so hard to get here." And so my mother was sold. She packed up our Volkswagen Bug, which very quickly got stuck in the sand, and we had to trade it in. I think it was Don Brady gave us a Bronco 2. So in any case, I grew up on Nantucket. I graduated from high school here in 1993, and went on to college, where I met my husband, got married a few years later, had my first child, spent the next 8 years in Portland, Maine, and then we moved back here in October of 2008 with our two children, and at that time it was three Jack Russell Terriers. So I have been living on Nantucket for most of my life, I like to say. This is our fantastic staff right here. This is not everybody pictured, but this is a very special group of people, many of which you may know. They greet residents and visitors alike on a daily basis between October and December. They are kind, they are knowledgeable, and they love Nantucket very much. So on the, I don't know what side that is, left, right, on that side, are our ambassadors. And last year we launched a new volunteer group initiative, Downtown Island Ambassadors. And they essentially take to the streets during our peak seasons and help people. They are armed with maps and other useful tools to help people. We have a new directive in our department. It's called Meet Visitors Where They Are At. Oftentimes for the modern traveler, they don't seek out a traditional information center the same way they maybe did 15 or 20 years ago. So these people meet people on the street, help give them some general guidance to get to where they need to go, and certainly if they need more information, they send them to one of our information centers, 25 Federal Street. We have a kiosk on Strait Wharf. We are at the airport on weekends in the summer, and this year we'll actually have an information booth at the Greenhound bus station, so that's exciting. So there will be a plug at the very end about how you too could sign up to be an ambassador if you're interested, and I even brought applications just in case. Okay, so these are, we've just recently conducted an organizational assessment, which is a really wonderful tool to do from time to time, but I think also with a change in leadership and a change in a department, it's really nice to get a sense of what the department's history was, where you are currently, a snapshot in time, and really identify where you want to go. So these are what we are calling our My Compass headings, or our five key strategies. Clearly, provide resources to tourists and seasonal residents in designing and undertaking a visit to experience Nantucket. And that could be resources that we provide to people at our information centers. It's information that we share with people on the web, mobile devices, social media. There's so many ways now that people are getting their information and making decisions before they leave their house and they get to a destination. So we take that responsibility quite seriously. Support activities and events and developments that contribute to the quality of life for residents. Clearly, our 4th of July celebration is one that the community is loves and is really a gift and a treasured time between the fireworks, the activities on Main Street, and the Children's Beach activities. We have in the most recent past partnered with the Chamber of Commerce to help facilitate their production of Daffodil Weekend and Stroll. And I think this year we're going to actually be working to help support the Memorial Day Parade with the American Legion and the VFW. So these are events that are important to our community. Which one am I on? Okay. Support the development of a healthy, balanced year-round and seasonal economy. You know, that's a difficult strategy to really peel apart, but in a sense, you know, having leadership at different conversations around town to understand how different things affect different stakeholders is important to always have that tourism lens in the conversation. So most recently, Libby Gibson invited me to participate in sidewalk improvement conversations. Obviously, these are really important ways in which our visitors and our residents access and are able to move easily from throughout town. It's wonderful to have somebody like me at the table just offering some insights. Sometimes I don't really say anything. Enhance recognition of and support for the island's cultural community. This is, I call, a distinct economic engine. It's a distinct marketing tool that we can use to attract people to come to Nantucket, and I'll talk a little bit more about that later. And then serve as a town liaison, and this is a typo. I did it, to event producers and businesses, not even producers and businesses, but event producers and businesses. And that's a little bit, there was a position that Amy Baxter held, and then she moved on to become the licensing administrator, and we hired Carlisle Jensen to come in. We could do a whole lecture, I think, on producing an event on Nantucket, particularly one that takes place on public property. But it's really important for these folks who have an idea to have a point person within the town government to come to and have that idea vetted and worked through to create the most successful event. Like I said, we can't always say yes. Sometimes it's a yes, but, and sometimes it's a no, but you can guarantee that when the event goes through its approval process, it's been fully vetted, police, fire, DPW, and a number of other town agencies. And Carlisle's role is really to be the liaison between the applicant and those town departments. So, in early September, I received a phone call from Bill Tramposh. And I'll never forget this because I think I was actually even homesick and I was making soup. And Bill called, and I never get phone calls from Bill, so I thought, oh God, I better answer the phone. And he said, hey, are you up for a crazy adventure? And I was like, well, yeah, of course. And he said, how would you like to travel to Busan, South Korea? And I was like, I didn't even know there was a Busan. Okay. And Bill had been invited to speak about Nantucket's whaling economy and a transition from that economy to a tourism economy. And he wasn't able to attend, and he very flatteringly asked me if I would go in his place. And of course, I was honored and said yes. Being the mother of two teenagers, I love a reason to get out of the house occasionally. So I traveled from Boston, and this was actually my flight path. It actually went up and over the Arctic a bit more, to Tokyo and then to Busan. And that was its whole other unique adventure. But I arrived late at night into Busan and awoke in the morning. I spread my curtains, and this was my view. This is Hyundai Beach in Busan. Interestingly, Busan is, I believe, the third largest country in Southeast Asia, and it's the fifth or sixth largest port. So they have a significant maritime economy, and they are a significant player in the world economy. This Hyundai Beach is a most famous beach in the country. It's about a mile long. It looks a little deceptively, either, I don't know, maybe it looks too small there, but it's manageable, and it is quite beautiful. What you don't see behind me are dozens upon dozens of high-rise buildings, and it's got a very metropolitan feel to it. So the conference took place at this Nurimaru APEC house. Nurimaru combines the words Nuri, which means world, and Maru, which means summit. It's located on its own small island. It's surrounded by beautiful gardens and stunning views. I wore the wrong shoes to hike the whole, but it's very vertical, and Busan's got, you know, you'll see these beautiful beaches and then big, big, big rocks and mountains right nestled in and amongst the city. Very interesting. It held in 2005 the Asia Pacific East Conference, which, as you know, involves a lot of dignitaries from other countries, ambassadors and representatives from around the world. And so they built this building just to hold that conference and then made it a museum in which you can actually see the room. It looked like a small United Nations room where the different dignitaries sat and met and talked about their commerce or whatever they talked about. And now it also holds some meeting spaces like the one I was in. It's a very beautiful building. The event I was asked to speak at was sponsored by the Hong Korea Foundation and the Korean Maritime Institute. And it's a two-day conference which was focused on the first day, issues of peace and unification between North and South Korea. And then day two was focused on cultural development and maritime economic development. I was asked to speak on day two. I could have skipped the conference on day one, but I was there for the adventure, so I went. And so here I am. And these are most of the speakers who spoke on the day one, cooperation and conflict of the international community for peace on the Korean Peninsula. I could go on for a long time about the substance of that conversation and those presentations. It was a very interesting time to be traveling internationally and at the right before the United States elections, and to hear the different concerns related to international policy perspectives and what impact that would have on the world economies that these people were discussing. So pretty profound experience. There's my name in Korean, which I just think is so cool. I loved that. This is Donald Gregg. He's a former U.S. ambassador to South Korea under George H.W. Bush. And Keith Luce was also in attendance. He's the executive director of the National Committee on North Korea. So I was one of only three Americans asked to attend this conference. I felt pretty flattered to be there. And these are the translator booths. So it's difficult to see because it's not set up this way, but when we did our presentation, there was a long table here, and I was on a panel, one of four. And different people gave their presentations, the translators were translating in real time from either English or Korean or Chinese or Japanese, and so they had these little tiny booths. The people who you see here, I picked the wrong seat. I was sitting with the press, I was with the hoi polloi, not the dignitaries, but it was fun, and she let me borrow her charging cord, which was really nice. This is Hyundai Beach at night. I totally stole this photo off the internet, so I'm so sorry, but the one I had was really crappy and I thought would look bad up on the big screen. The end of day one, they hosted a presenter's dinner, and it was given by the hosts of the symposium and sponsors of the conference, and they asked me to come up and say a few words before the dinner. So they were at a podium and were introducing me and sort of reading my bio and translating into, there was a translator standing next to the gentleman doing the speaking, and he said, "Melissa Murphy, she is from Moby Dick's hometown, and she is a woman," just completely, you know, threw me for a loop that was like, you know, staggering announcement. I'm a woman. And it was a very male-dominated culture. I'm sure you could see that from the photograph. I was, I would say, the only professional woman at the dinner who was not maybe a secretary or an assistant. And it was just an interesting observation. So after dinner, I took a walk on this beautiful beach. If you ever find yourself on Hyundai Beach, it's very safe. It's very family friendly. It was about 9:30 at night, and I felt comfortable as an American woman by myself on the beach at night, and I encountered people, young families, young lovers holding hands, walking down the beach. There were musicians every 20 yards. There were magicians. It's had a really fun atmosphere, and I appreciated it very much. So day two was focused on maritime startups and job creation at sea. And this was really the economic development portion of their conversation. And it was somewhat interesting to me to try to understand why Nantucket would be so important for them to hear about. And clearly, we have an internationally recognized whaling museum and obviously an internationally renowned whaling story, and our heritage is very well known around the world. And we also have a tourism model that is really attractive to people. So they kind of want to understand, like, how did you make this happen? We are a small island with, I don't know, we can argue about this, but 10, 12,000 year-round residents, 20,000 year-round residents, and our numbers go up significantly in the summer, and yet Busan is a bustling city with 3.5 million people. So what I wanted to do in my approach to this presentation, which I'm going to share with you, was really just start to understand, give them a context of who we are. So I started that by showing them where we are. And then also showed some whaling routes. The stars are obviously Nantucket and Busan, and I remarked at how much easier it was for me to travel there today than it was for whaling ships to travel there in the 1800s. Certainly took them a lot longer. We all know, and I think I'm going to say that I'm going to be pretty sure, looking around the room, that most people know the story of the whale ship Essex, certainly made very famous by our friend Nat Philbrick and the book In the Heart of the Sea. And that story of the whale that rammed the whale ship and the survival of those whalesmen captivated the hearts and minds of Americans at that time everywhere. It was such a profound story and loss, and Nantucket really was on everybody's radar at that point. And obviously, Herman Melville was really inspired and intrigued by the story, and so he came and interviewed Owen Chase and made his epic novel, Moby Dick. What Melville did in that story for us as a community is he really romanticized Nantucket's whaling past. He gave it that creative lens, and he captivated audiences around the world. Now, I will be truthful that I actually read Moby Dick. How many people have actually read Moby Dick? Bravo. For those of you who have not, my friend says there are two kinds of people in the world, those who have read Moby Dick and those who have not. And it's always better to be in the side that who have. So just bear through it. It's really actually a good book. But what the end result was for us as a community was it created a nostalgic sentiment for all things historic on the island. Our cobblestone streets, our cedar shingled homes, even the way the waterfront looked and worked and smelled and felt. So this is an important setting of the stage for the transition from the end of the whaling era into tourism, because when whaling as an economic engine for Nantucket ended, our community turned to the natural beauty of Nantucket and its historic preservation as its next most valuable commodity. So as the whaling industry declined, which we all know took somewhere, like the mid-1850s to late 1880s, it wasn't like here today, gone tomorrow. It took some time, but our population plummeted. And it was really clear that for those who chose to stay on Nantucket and live in the community, we really had to redefine ourselves in order to survive. And at that very same time, Americans were starting to explore recreational vacations and seeking places of respite from pollution that was being caused by the Industrial Revolution. You know, I oftentimes joke when I get sick, I wish my doctor would give me a prescription to go to the Bahamas for a couple months and just like air it out and rest. But this was actually prescriptions that people were being given. Get out of the city, go to the coast, live, take a break for a month, breathe some fresh air, relax. So the summer season really began to take hold in New England. And I'll just throw in here that my colleague Janet Schulte wrote her PhD thesis on summer vacations in New England. And although I have not read it, it's a really fascinating story. And Janet helped inform some of this for me, so thank you. So Nantucket started to leverage all of those assets as an attraction to bring people to come to the island. And in fact, in 1855, there was a citizens' meeting to promote Nantucket, recognizing the potential the island had in this emerging market. They touted Nantucket's pure air, salt water, historic charm as a place for people to come and restore their health and well-being. This ad is from 1910, and my favorite, all the benefits on land of an ocean voyage. No hot days, no malaria, no hay fever. This is a great, great ad. In my research, and I have a reference list for you that's available out front, and I highly recommend everyone take it because none of this is original material. I did not spend months in a research library to write this. Other people did the hard work, and it's very worth your time to read those references. But in 1907, town meeting appropriated $1,000 to support advertising and marketing efforts. And I just found that so fascinating because it was clear 110 years ago that the community was willing to invest in this new market economy together to attract people to come and to build commerce together. So around 1880, the American tradition of the summer vacation to benefit good health was really established, and Nantucket provided the ideal location. Between 1847 and 1891, Nantucket welcomed 8 grand hotels to the community, and in 1881-ish, the new railroad system was transferring people from remote destinations, so coming into town, and you could get outside of downtown, which had the benefit of increasing summer home ownership. And so then the seasonal resident crowd started to be able to get established. And I know that for those of us who live here today, we recognize that our seasonal residents are our friends and are largely responsible for many of the benefits that we have here today still. By the early 20th century, people began traveling more for pleasure. This became the idea, like, I need to vacation to relax and have fun rather than for health. And Nantucket again had to adjust its marketing strategy to focus more on the social and leisure activities as well as leveraging Nantucket's natural beauty and captivating maritime history. In fact, as Janet shared with me yesterday, this is still the number one reason why people visit Nantucket, is for leisure and to spend time with family and friends, to really capture those memories and experiences. So I love these ads. This is from the New Haven Hartford Railroad Company. And what I loved about it was how they were linking the history of Nantucket to this sort of cute modern village view as an attraction, like, come, see Nantucket and feel the history. And then, of course, this week on Nantucket, I just thought was stunning. I don't know who Flora Campbell is, but boy, she's, as my grandmother would say, a looker. Marketing budgets increased steadily, and by the late 1960s, the marketing strategies were reaching a national audience, and they started to shift and cater towards a more high-end market to attract a wealthier visitor, people who had more disposable income to travel and stay for longer periods of time. You know, I think that the year-round community received a lot of generous support and leadership from the summer residents, became adamant that at the same time as we were pushing for marketing and attracting people to come here, preservation was doubly important, became doubly important. So you saw the establishment of our Historic District Commission. You started seeing the purchase of open space and preservation of open space. And all of that was to retain, I think, the mission to retain Nantucket's, the attributes that made Nantucket attractive in the face of a vacation travel industry. And we don't have to think too hard about some other neighborhoods that and communities that we've seen that have somewhat gotten destroyed by the over-promotion of their vacation and travel attractiveness. Excuse me. So I found it fascinating that Nantucket is instinctively knew that our most attractive asset was our strong attachment to our past and our commitment to our beautiful and natural resources. Today, our tourist economy has grown beyond just the summer months of June, July, and August. It's extended, at the very least, from May through early October. And we have wonderful highlight weekends, thanks to the Chamber, like Daffodil Weekend and Christmas Stroll in December, which were really designed to give businesses that economic boost in a slow period. So what's this all mean for today and tomorrow? Because our economy is centered around tourism, serving visitors and second homeowners, you know, I wanted to share with our friends in South Korea that there are a number of real challenges facing our community as we work to retain a high quality of life for our residents and also maintaining the strong economic engine in tourism, which presents a lot of opportunities and challenges for us. So, you know, I don't have to really tell you all in the audience that some of our very real challenges are centered around affordable housing for year-round residents and our seasonal workforce, which, you know, our businesses rely on to keep their businesses viable and competitive, keeping local downtown businesses viable in a high-rent market, keeping our harbors healthy, and providing for the needs of our residents, like education and health care, including mental health care. Those remain challenges for us in a remote island because we can't regionalize, we can't partner with people as easily as other communities can. So I love this map. It's on the Conservation Foundation website, but more than 50% of the island is preserved as open space for residents, visitors to use and have access to. And what a gift that is really to us. I know that there's a lot of arguments happening within the community today about, you know, do we need more open space? We need more affordable housing. But this is really a treasured gift to all of us to be able to preserve what makes Nantucket so special, the ability to get in your car and within 10 minutes go for a long, beautiful walk in the moors or take a long walk on a beach, not have to pay to park on the beach. Thank you, Town of Nantucket. We don't want to ever do that. So the folks in Busan were very impressed by these strategies around land conservation. And I think because we're so inside of ourselves, we often don't step back and recognize that this is not usual. This is unusual around the world. Ahaba is monitored. God, I really try to not let that slip. It's monitored and cared for by several agencies to ensure water quality and environmental health, which, as we all know, supports our scallop fishery, other fisheries, recreational boating, and also those businesses that capitalize on recreational boating, like charter tours or charter fishing tours, whale watch tours. These are all important parts. I mean, could you imagine a day when Nantucket's water was so unhealthy that we couldn't have that arm of commerce and how unattractive that would be for people to come here? I think we have to, you know, we've got people working very hard at preserving our water quality, and they understand how important that is to our future. So I'm smiling because, you know, growing up on Nantucket, when I was going off to college, I was like, ah, I'm so sick of this old place. Everything is like so old, you know, and there was very little appreciation by me for the commitment to historic preservation. I'm going to just be honest with you about that. As an adult, I love it. As a person who works in tourism, I understand it's one of the number one reasons why people want to come here is because you don't experience what you experience on Nantucket anywhere else in the world. There is a very unique charm to it. And so this commitment of preserving architectural heritage of Nantucket really has helped support our tourism industry. It's been one of the principal drivers of what distinguishes us from other places. So this is a Pine Street home in 1808, slightly different, but you can still see, I think they've done a nice job of working to preserve it. More glorious examples. Main Street, 1840, and today. And I love this one because it really doesn't look very different at all, does it? It's our Athenaeum in 1870 and today. And I had this very beautiful long slide, which I won't go into, about this place. But I'm pretty sure you know where you are. I don't know if you remember the Whaling Museum in the 1940s. This is the photo of it from the 1940s when I moved here in the early 80s. We always had an annual class trip to the Whaling Museum and played in the park. And I had no idea who Peter Folger was or why there was a big building named after him. I'm sure they told me, I just didn't pay attention. And then lovingly restored in this beautiful renovation that's really created one of the most important cultural landmarks we have on the island. So dedication to smart planning and strategic economic development are really going to be the foundations for Nantucket's future success. As a community, we've made a decision to make investments and develop planning strategies to ensure residents have access to affordable housing. It's a slow, long process, but I do think we're making progress. And that includes, again, our seasonal workforce, which I can't underscore enough, is so vitally important to support our businesses because they can't meet the needs of all of these visitors if they can't hire the staff to do so. And to do that, they need places for those people to live while they're here. So, you know, there really is no us and them. We're all in this together. These efforts are led, I think, very well by our planning office and the Nantucket Planning and Economic Development Commission in partnership with other agencies. And in Busan, I shared this example of Sachem's Path as what I really consider a success story of affordable housing on Nantucket. Excuse me. In concert with other planning and development objectives for downtown, Remain Nantucket, as you all recall, was founded in 2010. It is a philanthropic organization that's made a commitment to venture investments that, to quote them, help to envision and empower a prosperous future for Nantucket by providing opportunities for sustainable business development downtown. So their venture work, and I think we all probably benefit from this in some way, aims to encourage people to come into town for commerce all year long. And they create a business model that allows people to design a business that may not have otherwise been able to stay open or afford the rent at a downtown location. And I'm going to call out my friend Justin over there. He did a wonderful thing the other day. He put on Facebook, hey, let's all go to the Dreamland and see this movie tonight and then go to the corner table for discussion afterwards. That's exactly the kind of rich cultural experiences that we want people to have and give your life a little depth, a little meaning, a little more interest, and is made possible from in part by some of these efforts and people on social media taking advantage of them. So in 2011, the state of Massachusetts enacted the Massachusetts Cultural Council's initiative to establish cultural districts throughout the Commonwealth. And they believe, as do we, that a thriving creative sector is really one of the most powerful economics that we have, assets that we have. So in 2016, after a couple of years of hard work by a dedicated group of people. The Nantucket Cultural District was officially formed, and it really embraces the downtown's wealth of arts, culture, and history. So also at the visitor center booth out front there, I have cultural district brochures for everybody that includes a beautiful map hand-drawn by our own David Sharp. It's quite the artist. But in it, we'll show you the footprint of the cultural district area and the assets, the cultural assets that we have in there. And we're working as a group to figure out the best way to market and leverage this asset as an attraction to bring people to the community throughout the year in terms of visitors, and also how to engage our residents a little bit more in cultural district happenings and what's available to them in this neighborhood. I'd be remiss if I talked about tourism as an economic engine without talking about our wonderful festivals. We have dozens of them. I know that with an eye roll, we sometimes say, no more festivals. But I think the ones that do exist, in my opinion, are important to our cultural community and to our economy. Most of them take place in the shoulder seasons and provide a little bit of economic boost. And they're also buoyed by these organizations that want to have a meaningful impact on the year-round community, not just in a short time. So you've got people like Kevin Flynn, who has his Stand Up and Learn program for children that takes place throughout the year. And the Book Festival, as an example, who works with teenagers in the high school, and the Nantucket Film Festival with their Teen View program, and their winter film series that takes place at the Dreamland. So these are ways that they can give back to the community, but also have these important cultural experiences. So I'd like to thank Michael Guyard, because I totally stole that picture from him, and I did give him credit. I think he's got a wonderful eye, and this is one of my favorite views on Nantucket. Free, you can just grab a sandwich and go there yourself and see that. And so I'd like to close by saying that although the issues facing both of our communities, Nantucket and Busan, are seemingly so different, Nantucket's transition from whaling to tourism economy is truly a story of democracy in action, and of community-led decision-making. Again, I think that when we're in our group and we complain about whatever we want to complain about at town meeting or public meetings or this thing and that thing, the 30,000-foot view is that we're very blessed that this is still a pure democratic form of government. And 110 years ago, when they really wanted to come together and build an economy, Nantucketers came together as a community and decided it was worth investing some money into tourism to build that business. And it's that kind of foresight and decision making that has led to all these other wonderful things: historic preservation, water quality initiatives, housing initiatives. And I think that was the most impressive point and relevant takeaway for our friends in South Korea. In fact, one of the gentlemen said it was striking to him that these decisions weren't made from the top down. Nobody told us you have to do this. We came together and decided it's what we wanted to do. And we continue to build the community that we want together. So when whaling as an economic engine for Nantucket ended, the community turned to the natural beauty of Nantucket and its historic preservation as its next most valuable commodity. And whaling and whales became the story that we as a community continue to capitalize on today. I'm totally happy to take some questions. I have no idea what time it is. Oh, I have plenty of time. Great. And I also have business cards up here I'm happy to give to anybody. Before I take questions, I just want to give one last plug. If you would like to become an ambassador this year, we would love to have you. You can always call us to learn more about it. So I'll leave that slide up as inspiration, and I'm happy to take any questions from anyone.
Let me come to the...
I have no idea. I know what I know, but I don't know that. And it sounds like a lot. It sounds like a lot. It sounds like my friend Michael May at the Preservation Trust would be a good person to talk about that. And they are within the cultural district. I can tell you that.
Hi, I'm curious. Does the town derive any direct revenue from tourism? Say somebody comes and wants to do the Nantucket fill-in-the-blank festival.
Yes.
So they're essentially using the name of Nantucket to make money or support a cause.
Yes.
What does the town get out of that?
Okay. Are you a plant? I'm just kidding. We do not directly benefit off of the brand name use of Nantucket. So every festival or thing that happens with Nantucket Inn, technically we don't get a surcharge for. And I had this really complicated slide, and my friend told me, you know what, Melissa, just take that slide out. You're going to make people really confused. But in short, I'll try to explain to you the mechanics of tourism funding and how we do benefit from it as a community. The short answer is every time someone comes and stays at a licensed hotel or B&B or inn, they pay a room occupancy tax. A portion of that comes back to Nantucket and a portion of that goes to the state. They also pay meals tax, so that we all pay meals tax when we go out to dinner, and sales tax. Meals tax revenue comes back to Nantucket, sales tax goes to the state. So our community receives, and I think in our next budget cycle, we've estimated about $4 million in revenue from the room occupancy tax and the meals tax. When we get that money as the government, a portion of that goes to support my office and our objectives and what we do, and it also goes to fund infrastructure support. So sewer, DPW, DPW is the biggest one, trash, maintenance, things like that. And there's lots of other pockets in which that money goes into the general fund and is used to support the demand that's put on our infrastructure by all these numbers of people. When the state gets their money, it obviously goes into their general fund, and they make different decisions about how they're going to allocate it. And there is a tourism trust fund in which, in theory, some of that room occupancy tax, meals tax, sales tax revenue goes to fund tourism initiatives, marketing initiatives, and goes back to what are called regional tourism councils. There are 16 regional tourism councils in the state. Nantucket is one of them, and our Chamber of Commerce is our designated regional tourism council. So they receive grant money every year from the state through the Mass Office of Travel and Tourism, which they are to use for the primary purpose of marketing Nantucket outside of a 30-mile radius. So basically, when you hit the shore of Cape Cod, count 30 miles, and they can advertise beyond there. So the other important way that we benefit, and I I don't want to misspeak here, but is that our attractiveness to our seasonal resident friends or our non-voting taxpayer friends is that they own homes and they pay property tax, for which supports the rest of our community and our infrastructure. And so, to me, tourism is that wonderful link that if we don't have that attractive, beautiful, it's circular, and I couldn't make a circle in a PowerPoint slide, so I had a bunch of arrows. It was very confusing. But we have this beautiful product, Nantucket. People fall in love, they want to come here, they buy a home here, friends and family come visit, and they spend money, and that money comes back to us through property tax revenue, and then through the other tax revenue. I don't know if that totally answered your question or not, but in short, we don't make money off of the brand name use of Nantucket.
Got a question in the back. I'll come to you with the microphone so Rick can hear.
Oh, hey.
Are you concerned about the potential loss of the Starlight Theater after this season? The local rumor mill has it that's going to be an upscale restaurant and bar. We're going to lose our nice little local theater, which is a venue for local films as well as the film festival. Mm-hmm. patio, which is a great venue for local and visiting entertainers. Bar and restaurant, which is an affordable venue for local working people. The last thing we need is another overpriced fine dining establishment out here that the local people won't patronize.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's more of a question, I think, directed to me personally, because in my role in the Department of Culture and Tourism, I can't represent the town of Nantucket has a particular worry or concern about that. I will say personally that every time we see another small business, family-run business close, we all become anxious about what's going to replace it. And it is that fine balance of creating commerce that supports our families and our year-round communities, as well as is able to adapt and serve our tourist economy. So, yes, personally, I am concerned about it. Having worked in the movie theater business for a long time, I think it will also have some impact on the existing movie theater and the inventory that they'll have access to, because oftentimes they share runs of films, and that's a unique negotiated situation. So in short, I would say yes, for me, personally.
Do we have any other questions from the audience? Any questions? All right, well, if you would like to ask questions, I'm sure Melissa will stick around for a little bit.
I absolutely will.
Please give one huge warm round of applause
thank
for
you.
Melissa. Many thank you.
Thank you
for joining
much.
Us today. Next week, we will actually have Mary Bergman, Executive Director from the Nantucket Lightship Basket Museum, joining us for Food for Thought. So please do come back next week. She's going to provide updates on their new exhibition and some new updates from that museum. So thank you.